Thanks for doing this.
Okay, I'm assuming everybody is rolling in. I'm going to watch the attendees. Yes, there they are. Great. Welcome, everybody. We're so happy that you're joining us. Kelly Powell Smith sent a hello message to you, Susan. She's
Oh,
participating tonight and she wanted to say hi. So,
yes, she's with us.
yeah, she is.
Great.
It is great. It's nice to have all of you joining us today to talk about this wonderful second edition of Susan Smartt's book. I have it right over my shoulder here on my bookshelf, right there. Right there it is. And I have had the pleasure of sort of learning as Susan and Deb Glazer were revising this book what the process is all about. And so it's really exciting for me to see it in full publication and now ready for all of you to take advantage of all the goodies that are inside this wonderful book. So we have made this webinar available to anyone to attend, but we especially planned it with teacher educators in mind because I think this book has a lot of application for use in your courses. And Susan has lived in that world and knows what higher ed is all about. And so that's going to perhaps be the slant that she puts on this tonight. But because there's also application, obviously, for folks who are working in schools, you're going to be hearing about and seeing that as well. So I'm really honored that we have Dr. Susan Smartt with us tonight. I'm going to be running the slideshow for her. So I'm going to go ahead and share the screen so we can get into that. And before I start, I just want to mention that Larissa is sending out the PDF of the slides, the handout that will go along with what we're showing. And that's going out by email to everyone who was registered. And those of you listening to the recording at a later date, we will post it along with this recording. And the last thing I'm going to say before I turn things over is if you are working in higher ed and you are not yet a member of our alliance, which is called Stars in Higher Ed, I'm going to put a link to join Stars in the chat. So once again, welcome, Susan Smartt. We're so glad you're here with us tonight.
Thank you, Stephanie. Stephanie is a doula that I've talked about you because you were so helpful in birthing this book. And those of you that have written books, you know that it is definitely a birthing process, a long, long birthing process. So I also want to mention before we start that at the end of the slides, Brooks, our publisher, is giving you, I think it's a 20% discount on a book if you decide you want to order one and it's good for a month, I think. We are giving away three books tonight. And at the end of our time together, Stephanie will come up with some fancy way to draw names. So there are three participants tonight that can expect a copy of Next Steps in the mail in the next few weeks. So this is it. Take your next steps. Next Steps 2 is the second edition. Deb Glazer and I did this book 12 years ago. And over the years, there have been lots and lots of changes, but then the research has informed us in many ways through the technology and the scanning of brains and so forth, different ways to be effective in our instruction. So we try to capture all of those newest pieces of the research. We think of this as turning assessment data into decisions and successful outcomes for all students. So that's who we are. And as I thought about this book and thought about the best way to help you understand it or how I conceptualize it, I thought of a Swiss Army knife. So think a minute about a Swiss Army knife. When you envision or think about a Swiss Army knife, what are some thoughts that come to mind for you? I don't know if we want to do that in the chat or just take a minute to think about. The other thought is this is kind of a one-stop shopping book. This book is a primer. It's a comprehensive primer, but the best analogy is to think of it as a Swiss Army knife. It has many, many tools that can inform and support the teacher of early literacy. So that was our intention. How do we distill all of the latest and current research into a very, very easy to understand and yet comprehensive book for those who are new to the science of reading and structured literacy? So this book, we have a really deep dive into MTSS. It's helpful for schools using assessment and even those who are considering the use of valid and reliable assessment. They're just thinking about it, just dipping their toe in the water. This would be a good book to get started in learning and understanding more about the impact and the utility of assessments. It's collaborative for teams and those that are making decisions, administrators. We have a planning template in there to help teachers develop lessons, and we'll talk more about the STEPS, the acronym that is in the title of this book. We focus on structured literacy, and we've updated all the five components of essential reading components of reading and literacy. And with all of those, we have multiple pages of activities. So if you just look at the next one. You can think of this as a planning guide that will inform instruction. We talk about the reading brain. I'll show you that in a few minutes. We've updated all the assessment charts for each component so that you can look at screening, progress monitoring, or diagnostic assessments for all five of the reading components. We have online materials and resources, which is probably one of my favorite, and it was the last thing I was doing in August and September, was making sure that for every chapter we had online resources that the reader could just tap the link and get the webinar or the podcast or the paper or the book. So that's a live, organic piece of this book that's current. Lots of strategies for connecting assessment to lesson planning. Intervention for early readers that focus on the struggling readers, practice activities for small groups and whole groups, and then lots of classroom-ready downloadable forms. So if a teacher needs to have a grid for scoring or for sorting kids, there are lots of different downloadable forms that are available for them. Okay, Steph? So Next Steps is, in general, a learning tool and a guiding resource for those who are dedicated to taking reading instruction to the next steps necessary for preventing reading difficulties and for remediating our struggling readers. It's all about connecting assessments to effective intervention. So those are the take-homes. And the other book, we felt like it was important to talk about what is it that teachers need to teach, what are the essential components, and then how to do it. So we took that same kind of model that we had in the earlier book and elaborated a little bit more. So structured literacy, what is it that we teach? We need to be teaching phoneme awareness and phonics and orthography and morphology and syntax and semantics and vocabulary. And those all have to be woven and integrated simultaneously. But equally important is the how to teach. So we channeled the Anita Archer and all of those people who came before us with explicit instruction. And we wrote about and gave many examples of how to teach with explicit, systematic, cumulative, interactive instruction with corrective feedback and data-based decision-making. So this is one of the figures in the book, and then we just elaborate on what each of these components means and then what it would look like in the classroom. Okay. We use the outcome-driven model and struggling reader, and through that is where the multi-sensory, multi-tiered system of support comes in. We focus on the different types of assessments that are critical in an MTSS model, and especially the evidence-based instruction. So that's a cornerstone as well for all of the work that we do in this book. Steph? Yeah, probably don't need to talk about each of those. And just quickly, you know, we've learned so much about the reading brain over the last decade and even more so in the last 5 years. So we have a section in there on the reading brain and stuff you can do. I'll go through these next pieces just to give you some snapshots of figures that are in the book. But we talk about the reading brain. We talk about how kids learn to read through the model of what we've learned through Dehane and others. So this is one of the figures that's in the book. And then we take each one. We talk about the orthographic processor and how when kids first see the print visually, that's where the information goes, and then how it moves on into the phonological part of the brain. And so for many people, that may not be new, but I think for a lot of teachers and teacher prep instructors, they may not have had the background that a few others have had on the reading brain. So we really wanted to include that in the book. And then the planning tools for this book, and the part of the name for the book, Next Steps, is the tool that we use to develop a lesson plan. So it assists teachers in developing the lessons that engage students through explicit and systematic instruction. And we provide a steps model for each of the five components. So here's an example of it. The first S of steps is the first part of instruction, which is the we do part. And that every day when we would teach a small group lesson, we would be in practicing and reviewing what we did yesterday, just a quick warm up. The T, or the teach part, would be the I do. This would be the explicit part of a lesson plan, Stephanie, where the teacher is teaching the new content for the day and she's modeling the instruction. The E, and the engage part, is about 4 or 5 minutes out of a lesson plan that we think of as we do. Students are independently or paired with a partner. Teachers are giving corrected feedback, scaffolded practice. And then we do practice the activity. It's time to see if the kids can start to implement some of the new content they've been taught. And all the time we're giving corrective feedback and scaffolding. And then the S, the last step of a lesson plan in a day, is checking to see how well the kids learned that new content that you were teaching that day. And so there are many, many different ways, as you would see in the phoneme awareness chapter or the phonics or the comprehension, how we would do the show that you've learned or mastered that concept that was taught that day. So that's a quick overview of the steps, which is the lesson plan format for each of the five components. And we write about those. We give examples of each of those. We have contrived classroom settings with teachers giving a script of how you actually can do explicit instruction for the five components. Okay. And then the five components. We took each of the five. Steffi, you can go on. And for each of the five components, we said, what's new since we wrote the book 12 years ago? How do we assess the component? When and how do we teach the component? In this case, lots of changes have been going on in phoneme awareness understanding, how and when to integrate phonemes during instruction. So that's kind of the overview of what the phoneme awareness chapter would look like. And here's an example of some of the newer understanding we have about how phoneme awareness develops. We now understand that in kindergarten, the beginning phoneme awareness starts with initial sounds. And kids begin to isolate or identify initial sounds. And then once they can do that, we do final sounds and then medial sounds and then kind of sweep back around and integrate all those. And then into first grade and beyond, we are focusing on later phoneme awareness when we begin to look at single consonant blends and 2 and 3 letter consonant blends. So we have this as a figure in there, and then we talk about how to do instruction, and we have activities and word lists for teachers to use to do the practice activities. Same idea in phonics, word recognition, what's new in the literature, how do we assess phonics, how and when do we teach decoding skills, early decoding, full alphabetic decoding advanced word study. We use ARIES phases of word recognition and help teachers understand where might the children be in this sequence of development, and that helps inform the focus of the instruction. So we've written about that. Fluency, what's new in fluency? How do we assess it? When and how do we teach reading fluency? We used our tried and true decision tree that we've loved from the other book. I think Stephanie even has co-opted some of this in some of her work as well. When we say, if the kids have established benchmark rate, what about the accuracy? If the accuracy is at or above 95%, hooray, hooray. They could do the core reading program. We can do extensions. We can do frequent independent reading. But what if accuracy is below 95%? And so we recommend listen to the student read. Are the errors decoding based? Are they reading fast without monitoring? So this is a decision tree that helps teachers sort through what their students are actually doing when they are established or below benchmark. Things in the below benchmark, you can see if the accuracy is at or above 95%. We talk about some fluency training, but there are times when we need to look at high frequency words. We need to teach regular high frequency words. And in this chapter, our fluency chapter, I took a lot from what's his name in New York, Wiley Blevins, has done such good work with high frequency words. And he loaned me some of his lists, the decodable high frequency words. And I developed a progress monitoring assessment to help teachers assess, can these kids recognize the word and or can they spell the word, and then begin to develop some instructional goals based on some of the screening and high frequency words. And oral language, what's new? How do we assess it? How and when to teach vocabulary? How to integrate vocabulary? We know that we spend so much time with the word level, word recognition level, but it's essential that we also work on oral language. So we do lots in this chapter about syntax and different contexts. And you can do the next slide, Stephanie. We think about, and I think this one progresses maybe with the word level, yeah, like we might be teaching the decoding of a word like chain, but then we have to think about how to integrate the meaning of that word. We'll make a chain, or she chained the gate closed, or all the different ways I will unchain it to open the gate. So throughout the vocabulary chapter, we're focusing on many ways to tie together the decoding with the word meaning and the application of oral language. The last one is comprehension. Same thing. We said, what's new in comprehension? How do we assess it? How and when do we teach reading comprehension? How do we integrate comprehension during instruction? And what I show here is an example of an activity in our book where we're considering the goal of comprehension. They may be varied, but this is a sentence frame so that we're focusing on the connective quality of sentences, the mental model, understanding what kids are reading, and leading them to put words into sentences that they've read and so forth. So comprehension has evolved, as most everything else has, over the last 12 years. And we give examples like this. We're trying to give a model for teachers to understand different parts of comprehension that are critical. And I think the biggest thing that we've always tried to do is integration. How do we weave all this stuff together? So much of the time, things are taught in silos and things are taught in isolation, and kids may just have a decoding class or a phoneme awareness class that day and nothing else. And so we're really big throughout the book talking about how to take a phoneme awareness class and match or lesson and match the decoding component with it and the meaning with it and writing about it so that it's all woven together in a lesson and not just left hanging out there. And of course, reading a decodable reader. And this is the graphic that we used in our other book of how, I don't know, back in the day we made pot holders. We could weave together these little things. This looks kind of like a pot holder. And the idea is that we might be teaching the phonemes of SIP, and then we might help match the letters to SIP so the kids get S-I-P. And then we might talk about the meaning of SIP. Could you sip your milk, or you could sip the hot drink, and SIP might mean to not gulp. And could you sip hot cocoa, with the idea that the written language might be Martin came inside stamping the snow from his boots. His smiling face was rosy red from the cold, and a sip of hot chocolate sounded delicious. So that's kind of our way of trying to help teachers understand the interconnectedness of the five components. What's next, Steffi? Oh, the online resources I mentioned, I think that's the last thing I worked on in August. And there are 20 pages of links, hot links to, and Steph helped with this. The Rhode Island Department of Ed helped with this to try to get the best webinars and podcasts and books and articles and everything we could to help a teacher have access, easy, quick access when they may want to know more. So we say, what will be your next step? The reading teacher's professional learning never ends. And so for me, that's the higher ed teacher prep teacher, and their learning never ends. And the second grade teacher or the special ed teacher or the school psychologist or the speech language professional, anyone who's teaching reading, their professional learning never ends. And we think our book really helps foster that ongoing growth. We know that reading instruction is changing rapidly. As we journey through this rapidly changing landscape, we determine our students' learning and the meaning that our work brings into lives. So the giveaway, Steph will figure out a way to give three books away tonight. And if anybody's interested and wants to consider this as a textbook, Brooks will be happy to send them a copy for exam. And it's just easy. You can just write them and they'll ask for your, if you have your university email, they'll send you a free book to look at and see how it may be applicable to your course. Some of you may know that Marty Haugen and I did Fundamentals in Literacy Instruction 2 years ago, and it's a textbook, and it's very comprehensive as well. And we had lots of contributors that were experts, and it's well used in higher ed and teacher prep. This book is a primer. This book is a first step. If you thought about your cohort or your students having very, very little background of the underpinnings of literacy, you know, we do the Scarborough rope, and we do, you know, everything that are the underpinnings is woven into this as well. So for me, it's just a great baby step as you're just getting into structured literacy. And yet it's comprehensive because it has all of the assessment pieces with it as well. And there's assessments in each chapter. So if you don't have access to professional assessments or their limited resources, you can use the ones in this book and just copy them and do your own phonic screen or your syllable type screen or your phoneme awareness screen or whatever you want to do if you don't have access to a broader range of materials. So one-stop shopping, but that sounds kind of capitalistic. So I like the idea of the Swiss Army knife. That's what this book is. And so, if we could talk about teacher prep and how, I just really wanted everybody to see what the book's about and then begin to see how it might fit into some of their coursework.
Yeah. So we can take people's questions. In the Q&A box is the best place to drop those. And so we do have a question related to what you just said about your other textbook, which is the fundamentals text that's an edited book. Do you see these two books being used in tandem or in sequence, or do you think that they could both be used in teacher prep, or do you think they have different uses?
That's a great question. I almost think of the fundamental one as a graduate courses. I mean, we wrote it so that there could be two semesters worth. We did two models for that one. I think while it could be used exclusively, I just think you have to know your population. You have to know the kids that are coming into your school and what they bring, or the teachers. One's just so friendly. Steph, how would you
discern?
Is.
Well, I'm thinking, depending on when you start your teacher candidates in the major, right? Like if you start them sophomore year, this is a really good entry place to use Next Steps. I'm also thinking if you only have a two course sequence, I know a lot of teacher prep programs, that's all they have is two courses. I think Next Steps is a really good choice because of it covering so much territory in a very practical and integrated way. I'm also thinking about alternative licensure programs and these intern programs where people have a bachelor's degree in something else and they're becoming teachers, let's say, as a career change, those kinds of programs, which are very, very limited in time. I think Next Steps would be perfect for that kind of a context. Let's see, there's another question here. For an educator, is there different information in both books, Fundamentals versus Next Steps, for a practicing teacher?
Yeah, the information is the same. The research is the same that's in both books, but the application of the research is more practical in this book.
Yeah.
You know, Matt Burns uses this book. He's used the old version of this book to teach his school psychologist because he wants them to understand assessment and recommendations. What can they help the teachers do when children are struggling with certain things? So this one is like a cookbook.
Yeah.
The other one just feels more like a textbook. And again, the content is no different. The content is the same. The research is the same. It's the application.
I agree with that. And Liz is saying,
if anybody, I was going to say, anybody that wants to could get them both from Brooks and just try to sort through what fits best for their students.
Yeah, Brooks is very good about giving teacher educators the exam copy, the desk copy, they sometimes call it, for free for a trial run. So you can preview it and decide if it's something you want to use in your course. Liz,
and there's the eBooks, you know, they're those as well. Of course, most of us really like the hard copy of everything so we can see all the pictures.
Yeah, I do for sure. Liz is commenting in the Q&A that she thinks this book, Next Steps, would be great for her state to use with the schools that are in the MTSS initiative. Right now, they use the core reading source book, and it's overwhelming. Plus, this one is more up to date. So good observations.
Yeah, it is. And we all love the core, and we use the core. The core stays on your shelf, and you pull it out. For me, it's always a great reference book. but this one is more nitty gritty. And even the core, Linda Dahman said, I can't, they won't let me update the phoneme awareness. And she reviewed this. She was so pleased to see that we got the good stuff, the new stuff in here on all the phoneme awareness. So yeah, we love the core, but it's gargantuan.
Yeah, and because Next Steps is framed within MTSS, it's so, Liz, you're right, it's a perfect fit as like a book study or something that you could lead folks through if they are engaged in your state's MTSS initiative. Would work really well for that.
It'd be a great book study, and then have them go back and practice some of the things and then come back and talk about it. Some of the best book studies have been collaborative. Amanda Nickerson has done that for years, where she does teaching and training and then sends them off for a month, and then they come back and they're able to share what was effective and what they learned.
Yeah.
So an interactive, engaging book study rather than just a content book study would be helpful.
Yeah, Paula is commenting that many teacher candidates do not enter student teaching with the knowledge of the components of reading. So this would be a great addition to undergrad instruction. Yeah, so even at the point of doing their student teaching, this would fill in some gaps.
Flip over to those activities and go, oh, here's one for tomorrow. I'll do this one. I'll do this letter chain tomorrow.
Yeah. Marcy is saying that she loves the practical application piece in this book. And she's thinking that this would be a great book for a university that is beginning their SOR journey. That's a great idea. So for like the faculty to do a book study so they could get this introduction to the research behind the five essential skills. That's a great idea.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. Those that are making the shift. And on a gentle way to make the shift, because we're very respectful throughout this, the judicious teachers and the teachers that care so much about their kids and the knowledge is evolving. And
yeah, absolutely. Very good. Okay. So I think I have addressed everybody's comments and questions in the Q&A. Last call, if you are still typing, get your comment or question in there. And I'm going to ask Amy Murdoch if she would help us with this giveaway. So what I'm thinking is that I can pull up the list of participants, and it's just a big long list here of wonderful educators who are giving up time at the end of their busy workday to learn about Susan and Deb's wonderful new book. And you are in luck for staying to the end, because you have a chance of winning a copy of this.
Steph, is there one more slide that shows the discount code?
There it is.
So Brooks will give you 20% off if you just type in steps 2-3. And it looks like it lasts until a month from today, if you know anyone that would like to purchase it with a 20% discount.
That's wonderful. That's a sizable discount. Thank you for arranging that.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And I'm happy to talk to anybody. My email is on here. Answer any more questions that are maybe more specific to your situation.
Very nice. Thank you for that offer. And thank you for sharing information and doing this preview of your wonderful book. Like I said, I got to live a little bit vicariously through you, watching you go through the process of writing this book. I know what a tremendous amount of work it was. And I know that your attention to detail and your attention to the work that teachers do every day and your attention to the research all comes through in this book. So it's kudos to you. It's very well done. And we're happy to share about it. Hopefully folks will use it to the benefit of all of those young children that they're supporting.
Absolutely. And Steph, thanks for putting it on your Christmas list.
Oh, yeah.
we made your Christmas wish list this year.
Yes.
We're excited about that.
Yes, that was good timing. Yeah. Okay, Amy Murdoch, I'm going to ask your, or Larissa, one or the other. So let's just do a random number don't look at the participant list because just
Amy stepped away. I'll help you out with this part. So you tell me what to do. Oh, there she is. Never mind. She's back.
Amy's back. Yep. So pick a number between 1 and 57.
I'll pick number 32.
Oh gosh.
Okay, how about number 2?
Okay, number 2 is Allison Pankowski. I better write these down so I can get these shipped out. Allison Pankowski, you are a winner. We will get a copy of this book to you. Okay. 32. I can manage that, I think.
Yeah.
We have 32 people.
Oh yeah, more than that. Yeah. Hold on.
57. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Katie DiRago is a winner.
Woohoo.
This is what you get for sticking around to the end of the show. You win a copy of the book. Okay, one more.
How about 55?
55. One. Let's see. Stacy Smith is number 55. And Stacy Smith is our third winner of a copy of Next Steps. Okay. Awesome. So we will reach out to you by email if you were the winner and get your mailing address so we can have a copy sent out to each one of you. And if you don't trust us to figure that out, just email us. We'll make it happen. Between the four of us, we'll figure it out.
One last comment. We read so much about progress monitoring in here and how it should be done and what to look for and all that. And I've had some people using this to help change what's going on in districts as it relates to progress monitoring. Because what I've found, and you all would know better than I do, is they'll do benchmark testing and that's the end of their CBM testing and they're done. And so there's no diagnostic and there's no progress monitoring. So a few people have found in this book, because it says it in this book, and then brought it to the attention of administrators or even attorneys. So if it's written, it's gotta be true.
It helps support the case, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, we can help people understand the assessment role that assessment plays in informing instruction over and over. It's not one and done.
That's right. That's right. Okay. Well, thank you again, Susan, for spending this time with us. We really appreciate it. We hope that lots of folks will take advantage of this great resource that you and Deb have created.
Thank you for the opportunity. And again, if anybody wants to follow up, I'm happy to talk to them. And thanks for all the work you do. Oh my gosh, all of you.
Yes.
All day, every day, evenings, holidays. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Have a great rest of your evening.